Turn with me to Matthew chapter 19, please. Matthew chapter 19. Now, as I said, I asked Paul to read to us Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 31, and Luke 18, verses 18 through 30. This account has marvelous truth in it. And there's far more than what I'll be able to cover here this morning. But what I want to read to you this morning is Mark's account of it in Mark chapter 19. And let's begin reading in verse 16. And behold, one came and said unto him, remember Mark's or Luke, one said, came running. But then it says, it's about kneel down. Isn't it amazing how in some places it said, and men or women bowed down and worshiped him, or some bowed at his feet? I think Matthew realized later he wasn't bowing, he was just kneeling. That's all he was doing. Behold, one came and said unto him, good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? And he said unto him, that is, Christ said unto this young man, why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments. This rich young man said, he saith unto him, which? Jesus said, thou shalt do no murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Honor thy father and thy mother. And thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. The young man said unto him, all these things have I kept from my youth up. What lack I yet? Jesus said unto him, if thou wilt be perfect, go and sell that thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, verily I say unto you, that a rich man shall hardly enter into the kingdom of heaven. And again I say unto you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. Remember, one of the other writers said that Christ qualified this when they really didn't get it. He said, they trust in riches. They trust in riches. When his disciples heard it, they were exceedingly amazed, saying, who then can be saved? But Jesus beheld them. Can you imagine that? I can see him to stop for a moment. Look around. Look them in the eye. But Jesus beheld them and said unto them, with men, not with the rich. Did he? He didn't say with the rich, but with men. I have every reason to believe he means all men without exception here. But with men, this is impossible. How much stronger word could you get? But with men, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Then answered Peter and said unto him, behold, we have forsaken all and followed thee. What shall we have therefore? Now I want you to notice how Peter talks there. He's not amazed by the fact that he did. When here's a guy who couldn't, he wants to know what he's going to get out of it. See it? See it in its right context. Here he's just moments before, he's amazed. Who then can be saved? But then turned right back around and said, Lord, we left everything. What shall we have therefore? Notice he just said we left it. He didn't say we sold it and gave it away, did he? Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto you, that ye which have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, ye shall also sit upon 12 tribes, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And every one that hath forsaken houses and brethren and sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive 100-fold and shall inherit eternal life. But then all three writers end up with this, but many that are first shall be last, and the last shall be first. Now Matthew continues on and explains exactly what that means. He's the only writer that does. Mark and Luke do not go on. They all three end with that statement. Matthew 20 verses 1 all the way down through verse 16 goes to deal with that, and he there rebukes everything that Peter had said out of his heart. I won't even deal with all that. Like I said, there's a lot here. Oh, there is so much here. I will begin my message by saying this. Our God never wrings his hands over sinners. You hear me? Our God never wrings his hands over sinners. There are those today who call themselves Christians that, while they may not say it that way, that's the God they present, up there wringing his hands in heaven, just hoping someone would let him save them. Our great King, think about it now, listen to me, our great King worked this man over, didn't he? He worked him over, Mason. He was giving him a what for. He worked him over. He exposed him. He silenced him. And the man left sorrowful, grieved, and empty. Didn't he? Now that's what we're told in the text, right? But this is not about failure on anybody's part. Now, you hear what I'm saying? It's not about failure on the young man's part. This young man was blind as a bat. He had interest, but he didn't know God. And this certainly ain't about failure on Jesus. Boy, Jesus gave him a good shot. He tried his best. That's blasphemous. That's blasphemous. This passage is about impossibilities with man. That's what it's about. Impossibilities with man. And then you read in chapter 20 when Matthew gives the account of how Christ summed this all up. Christ said, all of this is in my sovereign hands, and I give to people as I please. Go back and read that sometime. But I'm not even dealing with that this morning. It's about impossibilities with man. This is not about legalism on Christ's side. Did you ever notice Christ wasn't worried about being called a legalist when he told this man what he told him? Huh? Isn't that amazing? Now, I know there are those of the dispensational ilk that say, well, but back then you were saved by the law, now you're saved by grace. That's blasphemous too. It's not the truth. This is not about legalism. It's not even about legalism on the rich young ruler's side. He was nonchalant about the law, wasn't he? He was nonchalant about the law. It's about exposing obfuscation. He said, well, keep the commandments. He said, well, which one? That's obfuscation. You see it? Trying to muddy the waters. Well, which one? It's about exposing righteousness belittled. I've kept all that. When he told him which ones, what did he say? Well, I've kept all those from my youth up. You know, it's no big thing. From my youth up, it's about exposing ignorance about God. And I want to read that one again. And behold, one came unto him and said, good master. He called Jesus Christ good. Now, did he not? But notice he puts himself on the same level with Jesus Christ. How do I know that? What good thing shall I do? Do you see it? He does not see Jesus Christ as up there. Nope. Positionally. You see? He does not see Jesus Christ as God Almighty. He sees Jesus Christ as an equal with him. Just another good man like me. You see it? And now we know that to be the case. And it says, and he said unto him, Jesus said unto him, why callest thou me good? There's none good but one, that is God. This man didn't even recognize it, evidently, though, Mason, still yet. He's saying to this rich young man, you are not on equal ground with me, and I'm not on equal ground with you. I'm above you. I am good, and I'm God. It's about exposing ignorance about God. It's about exposing greed and covetousness, isn't it? This man was greedy. And covetousness is not just wanting something you don't have, but what you got, you will not let go of it. That's greed and covetousness together. Greed causes you to be covetous. You go after, go after, go after, and then you will not let it go. And you remember what Paul said about covetousness, don't you? What's he call it? Idolatry. Why? Because we begin to worship that thing that we're going after, or things that we go after. This case happened to be riches. I said this case happened to be great riches, one of the writers said, right? Very rich, something like that. It's about exposing greed and covetousness, which is idolatry. Look at Luke 18. Let me read it again. Paul read it, but I just wanted your mind to kind of already be tumbling over this. Look at Luke 18, verses 21. And he said, all these have I kept from my youth up. When Christ told him, keep the commandments. He said, you'll enter into life. And you know what, Mason? Christ was telling him the truth. He's telling him the truth. The problem is, with men, it's what? Impossible. But this man didn't know that, did he? All these have I kept from my youth up. Now when Jesus heard these things, he said unto him, yet lackest thou one thing. And one of the other writers then lets us know. He said, well, what one thing do I lack? That's what he was basically saying. Christ brought it up. Here's one thing you lack. Now let me tell you something. He lacked a whole lot of things. But Christ knew what the nitty-gritty was. He knew what the real problem was. Yet lackest thou one thing. Sell all thou hast. And he didn't say use it for the gospel's sake even. He said sell all you have. Distribute it to the poor. And thou shalt have treasure in heaven. One writer lets us know. He says then take up your cross. And come and follow me. And when he heard this, that's the rich young ruler, he was very sorrowful. One of the other writers said he was grieved, for he was very rich. Now hear me now. Hear me now. It's never a bad thing to have your self-hope vanquished. Is it? Whatever it is that you're holding on to more than God and Jesus Christ, His Son, it's never a bad thing to have that thing vanquished right at your feet. You see what I'm saying? Whatever that thing is, riches, a family member, your job, your religion, yourself, your freedom, whatever it is, God is supreme. His Son is Him through which God brings to Himself all of His gracious, merciful, compassionate glory. And God will be honored in His Son and His Son only, or God is dishonored altogether. But it's never a bad thing to have self-hope vanquished and ground into dust before us, is it? It's never a bad thing, is it? It's never a bad thing to be shut up under free reigning grace in Christ, is it? Is that ever a bad thing? And none will ever be brought to this place. None will ever be brought to bow to the authority of Jesus Christ and His glory until their citadel of me is cast into rubble. Whatever that part of me is. You go back and read what Paul said, 2 Corinthians 10, 4 and 5. I'm not going to read it. But the weapons of our warfare. Why? Because we're engaged in this battle. Yes, it's God's war, but God has engaged us in this battle. And the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. We're not trying to trick men. We're not trying to play emotional games. We're just telling men who they are. And we're telling men who Jesus Christ is. And saying, now, deal with that. That's what we're doing. And the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the what? Pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing it into captivity and obedience to Christ. That's a paraphrase, but that's what he was saying. That's a good thing. That's a good thing. But my mind thought, but some might possibly run off. No, some will run off. It ain't some might run off. Some will run off. And when you expose a man or a woman for what they really are, one of two things will happen. Rolf Barnard put it this way. Been trying to listen to Rolf a little more here lately. Rolf Barnard said, when God Almighty confronts you with truth in the middle of the road, two things will happen. You will have to stand there and deal with it, or you'll turn around and run.
Right. Yeah.
You'll turn around and run. No, it's not. It might. Some might possibly run off. Some will run off. Some will go away grieved and sorrowful. Now, won't they? That happened right here. Do you not? Does anyone here not know that our Lord knew exactly what was going to happen here?
You betcha.
And yet he did it anyway. Did he not?
Yeah.
He did it anyway. I thought about starting this out with this question, but I thought, well, I'm just going to give it all away right to start with. If you got somebody you love, and you knew if you exposed them for what they really are, and you knew they was going to tuck tail and run away, what would you do? If you really love them, you're going to tell them the truth, no matter what.
Exactly.
True love for the soul of anyone. Now you hear me. I planned this message 2 or 3 weeks ago. Began writing it 2 or 3 weeks ago. But you know some other things. True love for the soul of anyone cannot be cowardice or timid. And God help us if our love is flesh-centered and not soul and spirit-centered. Listen to me. Look at what it says. Mark 10. Amazing thing. Verse 20, and he answered and said to him, that's the rich young ruler, answered to Jesus, Master, all these have I observed from my youth. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him. Do you see that? He wasn't angry with him. Mason, he wasn't trying to just grind him in the dust just for grinding in the dust's sake. He's telling this rich young man exactly what he needs to hear for everything about himself to be broken down in the dust. He said all of this to what? Loving him. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? This is the title of my message right there. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him. Loved him. We'll give you seven things. Seven things I've drawn out of this text. There's a lot more there, but remember, that's what we're talking about. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him. And go back, remember, look what Jesus did to him. And look where he finally ended up. Now, you know what most people, I've done this before years ago. You know what? My concern was, well, if Jesus loved him, he had to have been saved somewhere or another. You ever done that? That ain't what this is about. You know that? It ain't what this is about. And others say, well, see there, I even heard one man years ago now preach that this rich young man, this is the rich man that lifted up his eyes in hell. And he was just all dead sure that's who this was. Why? Because he, you know what? Just because he wanted to prove that somebody went to hell that Jesus loved. That's exactly why he was doing that. You can't prove either side from this passage. Can you? You cannot do it. But it's here for a reason. And when the book says Jesus loved him, you can bet your last dollar he loved him.
Yeah.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes or no? Now the question is not what happened to him way out yonder. The question is what is taking place now and why?
Yep.
Jesus Christ was bringing him to the end of himself. He brought him right to that last thing. Even now, the rich young ruler gives up and knows, I can't do that. How many people do you know in religion have been brought to that? You know exactly what I'm talking about here if God Almighty saved you by His grace. If not, I'm talking right over your head and somebody's saying, I have, what in the world is that preacher talking about? Here's the seven things. Let me move on. Christ knew this was the one thing that would send this young man packing. Now, did he not? He's the Lord of glory. He knew this was going to send him packing. Yet he told him anyway. Yes or no? And he did it in love, because that's what the book says. Secondly, Christ knew this was the one thing this man would know it was impossible for him to do. Right? Everything else he said, I've done all that. Said Christ said, all right, here's something for you to do. Here's the one thing you lack. And he said, I can't do that. Yes or no? And let me tell you something, oh, my blessed brothers and sisters, that's where God brings every one of us to, no matter what our riches are.
That's right.
No matter what our riches are. Thirdly, yet Christ pressed upon this man his sovereign right and his preeminent place. You sell everything you've got. You give it to the poor. But now here's the main thing. You take up your cross and you follow me. Isn't that what he said? Here's the fourth thing. It does not say here Christ did this in love. It says then he beheld him, then Jesus beholding him, and I could see him looking him in the eye. Don't you figure? He's beholding him. One thing you lack then. And he puts this rich young man in the dust of impossibility and no hope. Yes or no? Now I know there are thousands that may even preach this very Sunday morning on this passage or one of the other two sister passages, and they have no idea that this is what Christ Jesus is doing. They see him as failing. They see the rich young ruler just not able to cut the mustard. And see Peter, James, John, they all did. No, they did not. No, they did not. And our Lord Jesus Christ finally summed it all up with this. He said, but the first shall be last, the last shall be first. And somebody said, well, what's that mean? He explained it in one of the writers. Many are called, but few are chosen. There's the explanation of exactly what he was talking about. And he's saying to Peter, he wasn't saying this, the rich young ruler done gone. Right? He's telling Peter, don't you dare suppose on God. Don't think God owes you this. Look at what he says in Matthew 20. It's amazing. Even while Christ was preaching law, he was teaching grace. Isn't that amazing? Think about, old Mason, if I could do that. Even while he was a preaching law, he was still preaching grace. Why? Because the law is meant to shut our mouths before God and say, oh God, I can't do this. Oh God, give me mercy. Oh God, give me forgiveness. Oh God, I'm dead. I'm corrupt. I'm helpless. With me, this thing of salvation is impossible. That's what this is all about. Here's my fifth point. Anyone here ever love somebody that way? Huh? That's a tough one, ain't it? Because we're prone to hang on to those we love like this. And if I say that, they just might. Yeah, they just might. But remember, God Almighty, it is with men, it is impossible. You're not going to ruin their souls by keeping stuff back from them. You'll ruin their souls by lying about it.
Right.
You tell them the truth. You've not harmed them a lick.
That's right.
Anybody here ever love someone that way? Oh, God, give me that kind of love. That kind of boldness. Here's the sixth thing. Compromise the truth about a man, and I mean about who a man is to himself. I'm not talking about preaching in generalities. Preachers do a lot of general preaching, don't they? Well, we've all sinned, come short of the glory of God. That's true, but Christ dealt with individuals. That woman at the well, she said, well, you know, blah, 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 all this. He said, well, you know, go get your husband. Setting the woman up, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He going to make her bring this subject up. And she said, hey, I don't have one. He said, well, yeah, that's for sure. You've had several before. Now you're shacking up with one. Now, is that not what he told her?
Yep.
He exposed her, did he not? Oh, well, she might have run off. Yes, she did. Ultimately, she ran off and told some other folks, I found the Messiah. Huh? I found the Messiah. He told me everything I ever did. And she wasn't pedoed about it. Was she? She knew he was right. Compromise the truth about a man to a man. Compromise the truth about Christ to a man. Then you compromise that man's soul. When I say compromise, I mean just by keeping silent. I'm not talking about going here and denying true doctrine. No, I'm talking about keeping your mouth shut when you see rebellion. Keeping your mouth shut when you see sin. Keeping your mouth shut when you see men and women, I don't care whether they profess to believe or don't profess to believe, and you clearly see they're in rebellion against God, then name it for what it is. And don't be afraid to say, thou shalt not, because God said that. Right? Don't be afraid of it. Well, I don't want to be a legalist. You've got more legalism in you, and I do too right now, than we ever want. But that's not legalism. The law is good if a man uses it lawfully. What's it do? It's to point out what sin is. Compromise like that by keeping your mouth shut and not saying anything, not wanting to cause waves. That's not love at all. Truth cannot be slipped in ecumenically. You can't LUV people into the kingdom of God. You love people when you tell them the truth about themselves and tell them the truth about Jesus Christ, or you don't love them at all and everything else is nothing but fleshly emotionalism.
Exactly.
Compromise the truth about these two things, what a man really is and who Jesus Christ really is to a man, and you insult God. You disdain his Christ, and you backstab those who are trying to stand for the truth. Do you hear what I said?
Yep.
You insult God, you disdain his Christ, and you backstab those who are trying to stand for the truth. Because the people you're being silent to will point their finger at the people who are trying to speak out, and you don't say a word about it. You let them mock and deride. God help us. God help us. Now, who among us can do what Christ commanded this young man to do? Huh? How many of us did that to get saved? Huh? How many of us sold everything we had, then gave the money away to the poor, and then took up our cross and followed him? Peter, James, all of them didn't even do that, did they?
Nope.
Let's be honest. But now look at Matthew chapter 19 again. And I want you to look at one phrase. He said, all these things, what lack I yet? In verse 20. And Jesus said unto him, and this is where he said, one of the writers, remember, Mark, he said, loving him. He loved him, right? He loved him when he said this. All these things have I kept from my youth. What lack I yet? Jesus saith unto him, if thou wilt be perfect. Note, this young man came talking about what he could do good. Christ is now talking about being perfect. Do you see the difference? You see the difference? But notice what he says, because he knows this man ain't ready yet. Don't he? He's not ready to make a profession of faith in Christ yet. He don't even know who Christ is yet. You see it? So he puts him in the dirt. He gives him the one thing to do that he knows he cannot do. Jesus said unto him, if thou wilt be perfect, go and sell that thou hast, give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. And let me tell you, if he could have, that would have been true. But he couldn't. And our Lord, they said, well, who then can be saved, right? Our Lord said, with men it is impossible. Who can do this kind of thing? No man can. And you go on to look at the parable our Lord Jesus Christ gave, and Matthew is the only one that goes in through it. Jesus Christ will reward you according to what he agreed to reward with, and that'll be it. It don't matter how long you worked, it don't matter how long you, whether you labored all day long or you labored just an hour or so. Go back and look at it. You see, this is all in God's hands. A lot of us may have given up this or given up that, but that's not the point. How are you really perfect? How that a man is perfect is not seen in what God even does to a man. Peter's perfection was not in the fact that he was able to leave and go to the ministry full-hearted. That wasn't his perfection, Mason. Do you know that? That wasn't his perfection. How is it possible? With men, it's impossible. But with God, what does it say? All things are possible. So how is it possible? He doesn't answer the question in this context, does he? Matthew, Mark, or Luke, none of them have Christ giving the answer to that. He gives anecdotes to what's said to him about what's happened, right? But his only actual answer with men, who then can be saved? Who can be perfect, right? That goes together, right? He said, with men it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Now let me just give you how a man or a woman can be perfect. Be perfect, not do perfect. Be perfect. You remember when our Lord Jesus Christ died on the tree in John chapter 19 and verse 30, it's recorded these words. He took that little sip of vinegar, then refused it, that drink. And he said, it is finished. You know what that word translated finished is? Comes from the same base Greek word as this right here, be perfect. He said, it's perfect. It's complete. It's paid in full. It's a done deal. It's all over with. There it is. It is finished. And then we read God's word in Hebrews chapter 10 and verses 9 through 14. And it says that Jesus Christ in his body and by his death set a people apart. He sanctified a people. And then what did he say he'd done for those he sanctified? In his death, he hath perfected in perpetuity. He hath perfected, same base Greek word, you see? He hath perfected forever. How is it possible for me to be saved? Jesus Christ died for sinners, and that's your only hope. Yeah. Give up everything for Jesus Christ if you can. Yeah. But let me tell you something. Unless you bow down to him who accomplished the work, who finished the work, who completed the work, who perfected the work, you will perish. I don't care how much you give up for the Lord.
Amen.
No man can sell out and submit enough to be perfect. That's the whole thing. No man can sell out and submit enough to be perfect. He did the perfecting. Do you believe him? Now let us go out and tell other people, especially those we really love, let us tell them that very same thing. Right? Oh, Father, as we continue here and we eat together and we fellowship together, Lord willing, oh, God, comfort our hearts and minds. Teach us thy truth. Many things in your word are perplexing, but only because of our muddled minds, our flesh, our emotions and our pride and our greed. Oh God, forgive us, but God, strengthen us too. Give us boldness to speak your truth in love, totally realizing that the world will not comprehend that love and will mock it. But Lord, bow us to it in Christ's name. Amen.